topic of my contribution is sizing of fire resistant cable in the way to in a way to accommodate the resistance increase in cables due to the fire. In fact, it looks like a very logic requirement that the conductor should be conductors safety circuits and conductors designed for safety circuits should resist temperatures which may appear in the time of fire, but we observe that in quite many cases this practice is not that certainly put into practice. Actually, in temperatures of around 900 degrees, which developed quite fast in normal fires in a building, the resistance of copper is about factor 5 larger than at temperature of 20 degrees Celsius. Angela, I think he already described what I'm talking about when talking about safety services. I think you can read in this slide what fire safety services mean and what kind of equipment is covered by this category. So these are different smoke detection and smoke evacuation devices, different smoke curtains, lifts for firefighting crews, of course, sprinkler and wetterizer pumps, different communication and audible systems, and lighting for enabling evacuation of people during emergency. Now, this is the equation which is commonly used for calculating resistance of metals, also copper, but it's valid only until 200 degrees, and then when we exceed this temperature, then the formula becomes nonlinear, and we've got, let's say, a nonlinear component, which is expressed maybe by the Weidemann-Franz law, which is 1.16. It's not a very large linearity, but as I said, you know, it leads you to a factor of about 5, which is well expressed by this chart. And this chart is a standard cellulose fire. So it has nothing to do with electrical engineering. It is a IEC. It is ISO chart. And in fact, we've got the majority of cellulose components in the building, because we've got plaster, carton walls, we've got a lot of furniture, and all these consist cellulose, and when they burn, so the simulation and is shown here, in about 60 minutes we achieve temperature of about 900 degrees. Of course, we can imagine more severe scenarios like fire of hydrocarbons, for example, present in different equipment which has a lot of plastics or so, or we can imagine also fires in tunnels. For example, these tests were performed in ships or in big tankers. So in extreme conditions, fires can achieve temperatures of more than 1,000 degrees. So even then, copper will melt, because as Angela already noticed, the copper melting temperature is 1,083. Degrees Celsius. Angela already explained what means cable which should resist fire, and in fact we've got either ceramic components or mica tape, or as Angelo explained, magnesium oxide, which and in all these cases uh, This either ceramic or mica type or magnesium oxide is a layer which is adjacent to copper conductor. Now I would like to say a few words, you know, about Polish project, because in Poland we've got quite a demanding electrical code, so we've got special standard for designing safety services, and only copper is allowed, because we can imagine. But we have enclosures for cable ducts, but the requirement that the temperature will not exceed, let's say, 100 degrees, providing safety margin, you know, for safety services, is really difficult, and it's never fully reliable. And in my country, only copper is allowed for these purposes. Only TN system is allowed there, because we've got one thing in case of fire. The insulation will always start to produce ionization, and this ionization is stable. It's unstable, and leakage currents will cause the RCDs to be unreliable when acting as short circuit protective devices. In TT systems, RCDs are the only probably effective way to provide short circuit protection, and because of this reason we recommend only use of TNS and TN systems only. IT is a very reliable system, but in fact it reflects very high short circuit loop impedance, and as I said, in case when it after first fault, because after the idea, the philosophy of having IT as very reliable installation, it's not to switch off after the first fault, but when we have a first fault, so the condition to have any sense for safety services is that it switches to TN configuration, not TT configuration. So it means in practice that you will have all the loads earthed together by one bonding conductor, you know, or so, and then earthed. Because if you switch it to if this IT switches to TT, then you have again need for employing RCDs, which, as I said, are very unreliable in case of fire. So what are two main criteria which should be taken into account for functionality of safety services? This is permissible voltage drop. So it's very well known for electricians that, that for example, the lighting flux depends largely on voltage changes, on voltage change. But these are not critical circuits. The critical are motors. Are motors which operate, for example, water pumps, for water sprinklers or different transportation measures used for evacuation or so. And for heavy load motors, you can expect that even a dozen or so drop, dozen or so percentage voltage drop will reflect in nearly 40 or 50% loss of torque. So sometimes even, you know, starting of a heavy duty motor is impossible. You may use different soft start techniques, but anyway, oversizing of equipment for voltage drop is necessary in case of safety services. Second is automatic disconnection during fault. And of course, in low voltage systems and for low diameters, low cross sections of conductors, the resistance plays a very important role. so important that in some cases, in very for cross sections like 4, 6, 10 millimeters square, you can even neglect the influence of reactants. If so, then the so big change in resistance has big influence into the short circuit impedance. And of course, if you the condition for automatic switching of a protective device is that the voltage between either live conductor and earth conductor or live conductor or protective conductor divided by short circuit impedance should be higher than the current which will trigger in appropriate time the safety device. And for this case, you can expect that this short circuit impedance will act in this way, that you will need to at least double the cross-section of a conductor to fulfill this condition. I think, I will not guide you through all this, what is now happening in MT34, which is about revision of 63.64.556 standard of Technical Committee 14, but we are now discussing and proposing new conditions in the standard, making the functionality of safety services raised at new better level. I want to only mention one thing, which is a fire switch, which enables additional functionality for fire brigades to easily switch off all the loads which are not necessary for the case of fire extinguishing or evacuation of people. And this switch is identified by letter R, I think. This is the one. It should be put, you know, in a safe department, fire safe department, and it should, as I said, enable safety for safety brigades coming to fight with the fire.